Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, you know, whenever, wherever there are two or three gathered in his name, so he is definitely here with us this morning. Welcome to the first 10 o'clock service. We're on summertime, so we welcome you here this morning. Today, we also welcome Reverend Gail Doering, is that correct?
From
the pulpit. Reverend Doering is the transitional executive leader and stated clerk of the Southeast Kansas Presbytery. We're so glad that you're here. Pastor John will be back in the office tomorrow, but the family has returned from their excursion to NYC. And if you watched the Today Show on Thursday, you might have seen the Wilson family smiling. They got some great pictures and had a great time. And I'm sorry I'm not going to be able to do the service in the style of Hamilton, but that would be a big letdown since that was the big highlight of your trip. Today is the first Sunday of the month, which means we put an emphasis on requesting that you consider making a donation to the deacons using the little green envelopes. When you give a donation to the deacons, it helps support the Hannah's House, the independence provider of temporary shelter for women in crisis, FAST, which is an emergency assistance fund, and the men's homeless shelter. The deacons thank you for any amount that you feel the urge to donate, and these envelopes will remain in the slot every Sunday so donations can be made at any time. The mission committee will meet tomorrow, Monday, June 6th, at 11 a.m. And please don't forget that the session is calling a congregational meeting for Sunday, June 12th, after the worship service. I don't like this next part. To end the pastoral relationship with Reverend Wilson, which will be effective September 30th, 2022. We serve the cup meal on Thursday, June 23rd. There's a sign-up sheet out in the narthex for that. And don't forget to mark your calendar for worship in the park on Sunday, June 26th. There'll be a cookout after the services, and we will get more information soon about the menu and what's to bring. We hope everybody will come out for that annual gathering. There's still a sign-up sheet in the narthex for a possible trip to the Sight and Sound Theater in Branson. If you're interested, just write your name on the sheet. Once the committee sees there's interest, they'll find out prices and let you know. And just because you signed the sheet doesn't mean that you have to go. It just means that you're interested. Does anybody else have any other announcements to make this morning? This weekend also starts the three weekends of Children's Summer Theater. On Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, there will be a play. It has kids from out of first grade through out of eighth grade. It's called Wizard of Oz, The Deleted Scene. It's really cute, funny. It takes place like an additional way along the Yellow Brick Road. They have been rehearsing here in our church down in Gaiman Hall since the beginning of May. So it'd be really, really great if Presbyterian Hymnal came out to watch that play. Saturday and Friday night, it starts at 7, and Sunday it's at 2, and that's out at the William Inch Theater. The next two weekends will be Frozen Junior, and then the final weekend will be Legally Blonde Junior, and that's the other show that's rehearsing in our space. Look, you put me up here and I got to plug my own stuff. I appreciate that. Please join me in the call to worship. It is a responsive reading found in your bulletin. We gather together because God has called us. We wait in expectant awe for God's appearing.
We are together, old and young, rich and poor. We have come, believers and skeptics, to this place.
On the first Christian Pentecost, there were surprises. The rush of a violent wind and tongues of fire.
We tremble before the power of the Holy Spirit. What will happen if we let the Spirit in?
On this Pentecost, we can receive the surprises of God. We can move to speak and act in new ways.
With hesitant eagerness, we welcome the Spirit. We will risk stepping into God's vision for us.
Please stand as you are able for our first hymn. It's number 291 in the hymnal, Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness. Silent prayer of confession. Let us pray. O God, we have built cities for ourselves. We have sought fame and fortune. We have rushed through our days with unseeing eyes, stopped up ears, and dull emotions. We are often more enslaved by our fears than freed by your grace. We demand proof of your existence, but ignore the work of your hands. We reject Jesus Christ as an impractical visionary. Your Holy Spirit is unreal to us because we insist on being in charge. Have mercy on us, O God, and save us from ourselves. God promises to us an outpouring of the Spirit. When we call out to God, our healing, our salvation will come. When we are ready to be taught, God grants us new insights and a deep, abiding sense of peace. Let us sing glory to God. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our first gospel lesson is from Mark, chapter 6, verses 30 through 44. It can be found on page 712 in your pew Bible or page 1433 in the large print Bible. Hear these words. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going, that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw the large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Now by this time it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already very late. Send the people away so that we can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and they can buy something to eat." But he answered, "You give them something to eat." They said to him, "That would take more than half a year's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" "How many of loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, "Five and two fish." Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties, taking the five loaves and the two fish and looking up to heaven. He gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people. He also divided the two fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of people who had eaten was about 5,000. I'm also singing today. It's a lot of Lisa, sorry. And I think I just put my music over here. Hold on. There have been so many times in the last few weeks that we've all felt the need for the presence of God. So this is a song that has a lot of meaning to me, and I hope that you will enjoy it.
Okay, I feel completely set up in about 100 ways in this service so far. First of all, John had asked me, I don't know, it's been at least a couple of months now, maybe longer, that this has been on my calendar to be with you this Sunday morning. And he wasn't sure whether he would be here. And the last time I came and spent a Sunday morning with you, John wasn't here. So I could mess up all over the place and do things differently, and he would never know unless you told him. He's up in the sound booth today, so that's number one. Number two, the opening hymn that we sang, a selection, an off-favorite selection for Pentecost, Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness, is written by a guy named Jim Manley. I went to camp in California with Jim Manley. So the memories just start flooding back, and then Lisa, hello, there should be 200 or 300 here, hearing that beautiful rendition of a song that also means a lot to me. And when I chose text and decided kind of what direction this service might take, I said, you know, I know it's traditional hymns and maybe choir or something like that, but if you have something contemporary that could go before the sermon, that's all I said. No idea that there would be anything. So I'm sitting over there sort of reclamped and tearing up, and now I'm supposed to pull myself together and be very dignified as your transitional executive leader of the Presbytery of Southern Kansas. I get winded just saying that every time. So I'm really glad to be with you and feel like I've already worshiped 100 times with you, and I'm sad I have to mar it with my own words in a way. So thank you so much for being here and for being Presbyterian, and for your faithfulness and however it is that you show your faith and love and walk of Jesus Christ, and that you have supported your church in so many different ways. And we hope, as a presbytery, we are in relationship with. I am not separate from you. You are actually, you and I are, we are one and of another and all together. And so I hope that you can know that and sense that. And as we especially walk through this tender time with your congregation, as you begin to look into what it means to break ancient schemes. I don't, not too ancient, John, but that God is with you and the Spirit moves in ways that we can absolutely not understand. So in addition to our prayer for illumination, will you just pray with me one more time? O Spirit of the living God, with tongues of fire and with silent breath of spirit, bring us together, unite us around your absolute and unending and enduring love for us this day. Make yourself known to us as you already have through the spirit of song and prayer and presence, and make it even more available to us throughout this service, but also throughout this day. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts and the deep ancient words of your text, all of those be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. I am reading scripture from the other holy icon of the iPhone that we all seem to carry around these days. And it's backlit, and for one whose eyes are becoming of that age, as the eye doctor says, that works really well. I want to continue with a theme from Lisa's reading of the Gospel of Mark into the Gospel of John. The theme and the idea that math is not God's strong suit. Now, some of you, first of all, may take a bit umbrage or issue with me even suggesting that there's something that God is not good at. And I don't really mean it in that way, and I think I stand in some good stead. St. Therese of Lisieux, a French young woman, only lived, I think, to be 29, originated this idea. I did not. It's not my idea. She said, God may have had a lot of wisdom and knowledge and put together the heavens and the earth and all these things, but he was not a mathematician. And I think in some ways what we're saying is not that he doesn't have that capacity, but that God is not counting the way that we count, the way that our world and our society has counted. So take that same spirit or that same idea into this next text, which is from John 12, verses 1 through 9, also can be found on page 752 or in the large print Bible, page 1531. I'm sure a text that is familiar to many of you, often read during Lent. 6 days before the Passover came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for Jesus. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly nard, of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume, but Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." Unless you think I have completely forgotten that this, in fact, is Pentecost, another passage from the from John chapter 3, verses 5 through 8. And this is in his rather lengthy essay to Nicodemus about being born again, and sometimes known as Nick at Night, that passage. Verses 5 through 8. Jesus answered Nicodemus, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." This is the word of God, and all God's people said, thanks be to God. So, if we say God is not so great at math, what does that have to do with us and the scriptures that we hear this day? I think that predominantly, and maybe it is a theme that has existed through history, of course, that we listen to whatever is the latest knowledge or finding or the ways of the world that guide us into how we might order our lives, how we, in fact, I think there was a prayer in here, how we might control our lives or insist on being in charge. Math as a matter of fact, is really good at that. Are there any mathematicians here? Because you're going to get blasted today. But I can say this in some honesty. My husband is an accountant, and that's pretty close to math. And what's more, that has to do with counting money. So I say this in all jest and all understanding, that we live in a system where these things are our reality, but they so quickly and so easily become our gods. And while the scriptures and the stories that we read from feeding a huge number of people, and again, with probably something of a logic and mathematical mind, disciples going, Jesus, I mean, it would either cost a fortune, or how in the world are we going to, you know, we should just send these people home, because we don't have enough. We're scarce here. From that to, you've just, in an extravagant way, wasted everything you have on this one person in this one dinner to pour what I have been told is something like 50 gallons worth of Chanel No. 5. That's the financial outlay we're talking about in today's terms. Those stories, and so many more, so many more, that just don't add up. In Kings, the widow who had almost nothing and not enough oil to make bread, and said, put some pots out and go get some flour, because you're gonna have bread and oil running over. And it wasn't until she stopped putting out pots that it quit coming. You know, I often think of that. Have we stopped putting out our jars? Are we in this phase of, we actually expect not to have enough? We actually expect scarcity in the ways that we have seen it in our lives, and fail to expect the goodness and the abundance, and actually measure that in ways differently than perhaps God is measuring that same abundance. So what does it mean when we say God is not so great at math? You know, 99 sheep or go after the one? Mathematically, it makes no sense. How many times am I supposed to forgive you for something that has wronged me, that is actually offensible? And yet it's 70, not 70, 70 times 7. That is absurd. It feels humanly, and I would argue it is humanly, impossible. Similarly, the table represents a non-mathematical setup that we feed from this table over and over and over again. We call upon Jesus and God in Christ and the Holy Spirit to come and make that meal different every time, and to make us all a part of Christ's body, and then to have it multiply and go out into the world to be Christ in the world. It's a foretaste of the kingdom. Mathematically, how does all that happen? In that table, it's crazy. Our faith is sort of nutty. And God is still not so good at math. A friend of mine who is a scientist was talking about gases. And as we talk about the Holy Spirit, and the passage that I read about the wind and where the wind goes, and we don't know, you know, that there are other forms of matter that fit within certain containers or certain measurements, but that in the case of wind, it's like a gas, right? And so gas will fit into, please, if she got this wrong, this is not on me because I'm neither a scientist nor a mathematician, but that it makes its way into whatever space is there. Well, that'll preach. Work with me a little bit. Think in an image of the Spirit will fit in what space we make for the Spirit. Our joy is made complete. How do you, you know, it's almost like you can add up joy and joy and joy. And another craziness about our lives is how many times do we acknowledge that we can give love and we actually, it feels like we're getting more? How is that? That's not mathematically or physically possible. So I then would argue that theologically, not necessarily physically or in our daily realities, but theologically, God does not want us focused on the number. It seems to me that throughout Scripture, again and again and again, God is focused on the relationship. God is focused on the connection, on justice, on love, on mercy. I think if we look at our world today mathematically, God's pretty concerned with not just 21 in Uvalde, Texas, but 8 in this community and 5 in another and 2 in another. Mathematically, it is not about the number, but about the lives and the torn relationship and the grief that exists. In the Ukraine, it is not about the money. Maybe it is about lives lost, but maybe not even about that, but it is about war and power and control and power over that has ripped and shredded a land apart. It is not always easy for us to figure out or decide what is right and what is wrong. The black and the white, the 1 + 1 = 2, they don't help us anymore. I think what helps us is these words of God's, these stories of relationship, these places where God abandoned the physical realities and the, I mean, let's face it, the resurrection itself makes little scientific and mathematical sense, but it was and is and continues to be and will be our guiding principle for the future, that the resurrection and the life everlasting is not about math or limitation, but about love, mercy, and salvation that comes this day to this house and that goes on and on and on into eternity, whether we put an equal sign at the end or not. God's love is infinite. This meal moves out and beyond in ways we cannot imagine. And Christ's church, in whatever form it has been, may not continue the way we think it looks or should, but it does continue. I have every faith and confidence that God has something in store. Let us be stirred from gentleness and placidness to be caught up by the wind on the sea, and lay aside our counting. Let God take care of the bad math. Amen.
Do I need to tell you to turn to 803 and stand and sing our hymn of response? Every church does it differently. We'd ask you to keep Dorothy Bailey in your prayers as she lost her brother, Ella Schmidt, who's been on our prayer card for quite some time. And we also continue to pray for Ellis's wife, Joan Schmidt, at this most difficult time. Do we have any updates for people on prayer list or joys or concerns to share? We will keep these people in our prayers during our communion prayer. And the cards today from Val that are in the back, we have a get well wishes for Albert's friend, Melissa Hurley. And there's a card that's for Four County Mental Health. Thank you to Greg Henning and the staff of Four County Mental Health. And as we watch the news and read the paper, we know that you are very, very important and helpful to all of us. And a wellness wishes to Michelle DiCioli, who is suffering from multiple forms of cancer, and that's Val's friend. So we ask you to keep those people in your prayers as also, and those cards are at the back.
we come to the math time of our service, where we are asked to give in that way in which we give from the blessings that we have been given in response to God's goodness and God's grace in our lives, and also with an acknowledgement that what we give, it really does matter, and it becomes more and maybe gets connected to something that you could not dream or vision on your own. So I invite you at this time to prepare yourselves to give God's tithe and God's offering.
Dark and there was
to that world for the goodness and the perfection that it was could not remain. But in thanksgiving, God, it is right and good and wonderful for us to be together and to say these words together as they are printed, as we come together in prayer, saying, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And Holy God, Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth, you also brought saints and models and wisdom to show us new and different ways. You blew through saints and you blew through prophets to say the way it was and to show us the way to come. And you did that down through history, even to this very day. And so for that, we say thank you and give thanks. And we thank you for Christ and who he was and who he is and who he reigns and will be forevermore. And it is through all of these things, it is the power of your Holy Spirit that descends this day, as in the days of old. And we pray that that same Spirit will revive us again, will make us one, one body with you, one in Christ, and one to go forth from this meal, renewed, remade, and rejuvenated. And so in all of these things, we do give thanks, and as we come to this table, we also come in remembrance, those who have gathered here before, those who have come, those who have died, those who have risen with you, those who are just away for this day. God, we pray for all of them, for those who have been named and listed who we will send cards to. We pray for all of them as we pray for this community. We pray thanksgiving for time away and for John's safe return with his family. And now, O God, in united voices, we pray again for the things that you taught us to pray for, and in a way that you taught us to pray, with your Son, Jesus Christ, who prayed and said, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And it was on the night that Jesus was arrested and met his death on the cross that he gathered with his disciples. And he took bread, a common loaf, and a regular meal with his friends. And he blessed the bread, he broke it. And he gave it to them and said, Take now and eat, for this is my body given for you. And in the same way, Jesus took the cup and he poured into it. And he said, This cup is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Take, drink of it, all of you, in remembrance of me. And so, as often as you eat bread and drink cup, you do proclaim Christ's death until he comes again in glory. Friends, these are the gifts of God for all of us, the people of God. You will receive the communion in your pews. Most of you probably know this. It's all new territory for me. That you will receive the bread and take the bread as it is given, showing that we take Christ's body and meet him in different ways. And then when we pass the cup secondarily, we will hold inviting our servants to come forward.
Thank you.
go from this place, I invite you to put aside your calculators and set aside your spreadsheets and your number trackers, and to simply allow the love of God to emit and effuse from you, and to receive that same love from Christ, and to watch it multiply over and over again, and know that the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and yes, the immutable, the unstoppable Holy Spirit will hold each of you now and forevermore. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.